So I would like to talk about obstetric anal sphincter injuries, which we call OASIS. And OASIS stands for the combined third and fourth degree tears that happen as part of childbirth. The Royal College of Obs and Gyne in the UK would require us to declare any potential conflict. And there are a few here on this list. Some of the images are available from online resources. They're not necessarily mine, and I'll mention them when the time comes. I am heavily involved in running multi-professional training programs. However, any royalty fees or honoraria that are generated from these do not go into my personal bank account at all. They are used to fund academic activities. I've also done some consultancy work for Oslo University and for the Norwegian Medical Council. So my first proper slide is a fact. This is data from the UK, and over the past 12 years, the obstetric anal sphincter injury rate in the UK has increased significantly. It has tripled, increased from under 2% to nearly 6%. What is the OASIS rate in Kuwait? Probably you don't know. But all of you also think it's certainly much, much lower than 6%. And if we take a very conservative estimate, let's assume it is only 2%. In the maternity hospital, I understand you have 12,000 deliveries. So this means that in a year, 12,000 per year. So this means in a year, you should have about 240 obstetric anal sphincter injuries. If you think in your hospital you're having less than that, then there is a big possibility that you're missing a lot. So it's something that you need to reflect on. When we were running the symposium yesterday, I've heard, for example, that some people have only seen maybe two OASIS throughout their training. So it's something that maybe you need to go back and think about it. But why did the rate go up in the UK that much? People say because we recognize it better. But actually, is this the full story or not? Maybe better recognition. You can obviously increase your the incidence, because otherwise this would have been missed. But what's more important is maybe we have also changed the way we do obstetrics in the UK over the past few years, hence ended up increasing our OASIS rate. These are the risk factors that are listed in any textbook for obstetric anal sphincter injuries. And as you can see from this long list, it's very difficult, really, for you as an obstetrician to be looking after a patient that does not have any of these risk factors. The odds would say that every single patient we are looking after has at least one of these risk factors. I'm going to take you back quite a few years in the past. In 1897, this is a quote from Dr. Henry Gellett, who described perineal lacerations. Of course, at that time, he did not necessarily classify them into second and third degree tears or complete and incomplete even, as we used to call them in the past. But he just talked about perineal lacerations. And his quote is that it occurs far more frequently than it is supposed to occur. So even in 1897, this was an observation. But the second observation is really quite crucial. Unless you look for it, you're going to miss it. And many, many, many years later, the NICE guideline in the UK requested every single practitioner in the UK who is involved in assessing the perineum after a childbirth to do a perirectal examination, which it took us in the UK about 5 years to get the NICE guidance to include this. So if you do not do a rectal examination as part of your initial assessment of any perineal trauma, you're going to miss a huge number of obstetric anal sphincter injuries. I also want to elaborate that rectal examination in itself is not enough. You need to do this technique, which is the pill rolling movement. And I'll keep mentioning this because if you just have this intervention within your hospital, trust me, you're going to find that you have been missing lots of third degree tears and you did not even know about it.
And these are data from the University Hospital of North Staffordshire, where I worked before I moved to Birmingham. And these are data from 1994 on the left-hand side of the slide. And this was their the number of OASIS patients they had in a year. They delivered at that time just under 6,000 women. They only had 13 patients with OASIS. Then a few years later, they actually delivered 1,000 patients less, and their OASIS rate was much higher. Why was that? What has happened in the year 2000 is that Chris Kettle, who's a midwife there, now Professor Kettle, she was starting to do a clinical trial as part of her PhD to look at the best suture material to repair an episiotomy. And for to ensure that she's recruiting patients with second degree tears, she got all the midwives on labor ward trained to assess the trauma properly so that they can pick up the second degree tears. Once these midwives started assessing the trauma properly, the OASIS rate have gone up significantly. So if in 2 or 3 months' time in the maternity hospital, your OASIS rate starts going up, don't blame me because you've run a symposium. It's just because you're getting better in picking them up. So there is no doubt that it is an issue. If you don't think it's an issue in your hospital, it's just because you're not looking good well enough. Because it's an issue, now we need to talk about how we can reduce these quite significant traumas that will have a significant impact on this young woman for the rest of her life. I did my training in obstetrics in Egypt, and in Egypt, I have seen women delivering in one position, lying on their back, legs in stirrups, pushing a baby out. I've never seen anything except that. Then I moved to the UK in 1996, and I remember my first on-call, I was crash-called, I was the SHO, into one of the rooms, and I walked in, and there was a woman lying on all fours. Have you seen this position before? Knee chest position, woman pushing a baby out. And I just looked at this woman, looked at the midwife, and I told the midwife, what is happening? And she said, she's having a baby. And I said, can you put her in the right position? And she said, well, she is in the right position. The reason I say this story is that lithotomy is not the only position. And for us as obstetricians, we do that because this is what we are trained to do. One of my medical students who was doing an intercalation degree throughout her medical school, Emma Watts, wanted to do a project, and I suggested that we look into the literature about the impact of birth position on perineal trauma, particularly OASIS. Very few RCTs, lots of non-randomized studies, and you might not be happy to know this, you might be shocked to know this, you might already know this, but every single position, apart from lithotomy, is better when it comes to OASIS injuries. So for women delivering in left lateral position, for women delivering on all fours, the risk of OASIS is reduced compared to lithotomy position. I'm not suggesting that you go and do ventouses and forceps in left lateral position or all fours, because I don't know how to do this, and you probably would not know how to do this. But if a woman is going to have a normal birth and she herself is preferring a particular position, please let her take whatever position she prefers rather than tying her legs into stirrups and expecting her to keep pushing. However, avoid getting women into squatting or standing positions when they give birth, because these are still much worse than lithotomy. Episiotomy, the second most surgical procedures in medicine, is an episiotomy. What is the first most common surgical procedure in medicine? Cutting the umbilical cord, which we do as well. Until I joined a European team, which they are my colleagues and we do lots of training together, I thought that episiotomy is just one procedure. Certainly, indeed, before I even moved to the UK, I thought every single primary gravida will definitely have an episiotomy. How can somebody deliver without an episiotomy? And these are, this is data from a study that we've done in Denmark on just over 84,000 women, looking at the rates of episiotomy over a long period of time. Certainly, you cannot justify cutting the perineum on every single woman to stop her from having a tear, because you're causing a tear to stop a tear, so it doesn't really make any sense. So liberal episiotomy is not really a good policy, or routine episiotomy is not a good policy. But also very restrictive episiotomy policies are not very good episiotomy policies. And if you look at these data, in Aarhus University in Denmark, they've reduced their episiotomy rate to as low as sometimes 5%. And you can see their OASIS rate over the same period of time going up. So you have to look at your episiotomy rate. Don't use a routine episiotomy, but at the same time, don't use a very restrictive policy. I told you episiotomy is the second most surgical procedure. I've always thought there is only one type of episiotomy. I've heard in America they do midline episiotomy, so maybe two types of episiotomy. But I didn't know until I started working with this group that if you deliver in the Netherlands, you have a left mediolateral episiotomy. If you deliver in Norway, you have a right lateral episiotomy. If you deliver in Finland, you have a left lateral episiotomy. Obviously, if you deliver in the UK, you have a right mediolateral episiotomy. And I understand in Kuwait, you do also right mediolateral episiotomy. So everybody seems to be cutting the perineum in a different direction, some of them starting in the midline, others starting laterally. What's more important is whatever technique you're going to use is what is the angle you're cutting at. We don't really think about this. This is a study we've done in the UK. We got 100 experienced doctors and 100 experienced midwives to cut episiotomies on a training model. And then we can remove the perineum on this model and measure the angle of that episiotomy. Only 12% cut an episiotomy at the right angle. 88% of what practitioners cut is an incorrect angle. And the angle tends to be smaller than what it should be. The angle that we recommend is that the episiotomy is cut at an angle of 60 degrees at least, so that once the head is delivered and the perineum is less distended, the angle will shrink by about 20 degrees, so it gets to about 40 degrees, which is what a mediolateral episiotomy should be. And this is a study from South Ireland, Republic of Ireland, which shows that for every 6 degrees reduction in the angle of the episiotomy, or for any 6 degrees increase, you'll be reducing or increasing, depending on which direction you're going, the risk of OASIS by 50%. So on your labor ward, if there is one intervention you want to adopt from tomorrow and ensure that you're going to reduce your OASIS rate significantly, it is the angle of your episiotomy. Make sure that when you cut it at least at 60 degrees from the midline. The second intervention that I would like to talk about is manual perineal support. I understand that everybody in Kuwait does manual perineal support. In Egypt, we always did manual perineal support. In the UK, this does not happen. However, if you ask people, what do you do when you do manual perineal support, you will find that people are doing different things. Some people are just pressing, some people are trying to control the head, some people are trying to push the perineum quickly over the baby's face, and each person will tell you that their technique is the best technique. And each person will tell you, if you tell them what is the name of your technique, they will say, my technique is called Rydgen maneuver. But actually, the reality is very different. This is, again, taking you back to the history, 1767, Harvey was quoted saying, were the delivery left to nature, the perineum would generally be torn. So a very sensible guy. So if you don't do anything about it, the perineum is going to tear. So please do something about it. It was not surprising that in 1855, Rydgen adopted this technique. German obstetrician adopted this technique. The Rydgen maneuver, the original Rydgen maneuver, is he presses so hard on the perineum to reach the baby's chin when it's inside and delivers the baby out. Sometimes he even put more than one finger in the patient's anus to be able to reach the chin. Will your patients let you do this? No. So nobody does Rydgen maneuver. So when people say, I do the Rydgen maneuver, you say, no, you definitely don't. Sadly, you get a Cochrane review that looks at RCTs published in Cochrane, and this is what obviously is used in the UK as evidence for guidelines, where it says RCTs do not demonstrate any difference between using perineal support or no perineal support. And you start going into a debate of whether you do hands-on or hands-off technique. And unfortunately, lots of people in the UK adopt a hands-off technique. And this is a systematic review that you've published recently in BJOG, and we've confirmed what the Cochrane have demonstrated. When you look at the RCTs, There is no difference whatsoever whether you support the perineum or not. However, none of these randomized trials have been designed to look at OASIS as an outcome. These are RCTs of fairly small numbers. When you look at a systematic review of non-randomized studies, which is published in the same paper, you can see the significant benefit of doing a manual perineal support. But it needs to be the right technique. And what is the right technique? I'm going to take you to another European country. This is these are now the Nordic countries. And these are data for OASIS rates in all the Nordic countries. You can see all of them have rates hovering around 4% or even higher sometimes, except Finland, with an OASIS rate of less than 1%. Amazing OASIS rate. And the good thing is that a Finnish consultant, a Finnish obstetrician, moved to Norway. At the same time, I moved to the UK. She moved to Norway to do some training there. And she was shocked when she saw the OASIS rates in Norway. But she was more shocked when she realized that they don't do manual support. And when they don't do it properly. And these are Katharina Leine's hands on a training model. Katharina Leine is a big advocate of manual perineal support. And this is the Finnish technique. This is the technique they use in Finland. You can see it's a complex technique. They use both hands, one to control the delivery of the head, and the other one is doing lots of things. Supporting the perineum, and you're bringing the index and thumb fingers together, so you're reducing the tension in the midline. With the middle finger, is doing something like a modified Rydgen. It's pressing against the perineum and reaching in a way, or at least applying some pressure on the baby's chin. So you're controlling the baby's head coming out. This is really quite a complex intervention because it combines different techniques of hand grips together. And Katharina have developed quite a wide quality improvement project within Norway. She was able to reduce OASIS rate in Norway from the 4% to below 2%. And now actually the latest figures is that they have reached a level that is very equivalent to Finland. So this is, again, another intervention which you can adopt quite easily as long as you do the proper technique to ensure that you reduce your OASIS rate. However, we've heard today about personalized care several times from Dr. Abhair and from Professor Soni, and it is really quite important that when you see your patients, you give them the care that is relevant to them rather than generic care. And in order to try and think about what is the individualized risk for a patient of having OASIS so that you can try to think about what intervention you can do to reduce this risk, we've done a study again in Denmark on this cohort I showed you about episiotomy, where we looked at a Danish birth database of nearly 85,000 women. We've excluded the cesarean section, and we've used their cohort of vaginal birth women to develop a prediction model that can tell you what is the risk for each particular woman of having an OASIS before and throughout the process of childbirth. Interestingly, out of all the variables I showed you before, our model confirmed that these are the actual risk factors for third and fourth degree tears, which again is not a surprise to you. However, the most significant one of them is the length of the second stage. So be very careful when you are looking after your patients that you don't prolong their second stage for a very long time. You have to intervene at one point. Once it exceeds an hour of second stage of pushing, the risk of third degree tear increases significantly. And I've shown, this is a paper that we've published recently. It's a prediction model. It's an obstetric sphincter injury risk identification system, or OSIRIS. Coming from Egypt, I like calling ancient Egyptian names to different things, I guess. And OSIRIS is a prediction model that we use to tell a patient what's her individual risk of having an OASIS if she opts for whatever plan she's considering. And this is an example of how this prediction model works. This is a 20-year-old woman who is having her third baby, who is has pushed for less than half an hour. The baby is OA, and she is delivering at 38 weeks. And she delivered. What do you think would be her background risk of having a third degree tear? It's very low. And actually, the prediction model, if we use it, it tells us that this woman's risk is only 7 in 1,000. So it's a very small risk. So if we treat her like any multiple, say your risk is 0.5%, as we quote to other women, for her, actually, it's meaningless. Her risk is much lower than this. If we change this to a 42-year-old woman who has been pushing for more than an hour, the baby is in OP position, but not big or anything at all, what's her risk of having an oasis? Actually, her risk is nearly 10%. You can see the difference between the 7 in 1,000 to 10%. If we change this scenario to the same woman, but this time we add other risk factors to this prediction model, her baby we think is big and she might need an instrumented delivery, and you're either not going to do an episiotomy or do an improper episiotomy, what's the risk of having a third degree tear? More than 50%. And you can, if on the other hand, you do a proper mediolateral episiotomy with a good angle, you could actually reduce that risk to, again, 10%. So it's a significant drop. So whatever intervention we do is something that impacts significantly on the risk of oasis. So you cannot treat all the patients the same, and you have to do something really about it to be able to reduce that risk. So to conclude, it's important to use both thumb and index in the pirrolling technique to make sure that you reduce the risk of missing oasis after a perineal trauma. I recommend that you adopt a selective, not restrictive, and indeed not routine episiotomy policy. You have to give a huge attention to the angle and type of your episiotomy. Do manual perineal support, but do the correct technique rather than just putting your hands on the perineum. And please think about individualized patient risk, because whatever decision we make is going to impact significantly on this woman. I would like to acknowledge the team who have helped me a lot in the studies that we've undertaken. They've all been acknowledged in the relevant slides. And I would like to thank you very much for listening to me.